And boy, do we have a lot of change. It's a hive of activity down here. Hopefully, throughout this live, you'll be able to hear us well enough. But it's Jack Gorse and also our tech expert, Simon Crafar, down here to run you through exactly what we've seen. And obviously today, the biggest story of the day by far is that Marc Márquez, for the first time in his MotoGP career, is on a different machine to a Honda. That first swing over at Ducati, everyone was jostling down there to see his first exit. And it was chaos, and so far he has proven that, well, he's dealt with it immediately. It's been a brilliant transition already, straight away. Simon, let's dive straight in with Marc. So much expectation, so much hype. It's been brilliant, and he's delivered already.
He has. The thing is, he's got a 23 bike, like all the satellite teams have. VR46 and Gresini have those 23 bikes, where the other, you know, Pramac and factory Ducati have a 23 machine and the new factory machine. So Marc has a really proven Ducati, you know, the championship winning one.
Yeah.
All I can see is it is missing the special new start devices. They're obviously still quite rare because they're only in the factory Ducati garage and the Pramac garage. But that bike, I rode the 22 one,
yeah,
and it's only really an engine update since the one I rode, and it was the most amazing experience on two wheels of my life, meaning everything was so sweet, meaning it had nothing I could complain about, you know? Every area was the best thing I've ever ridden, and I'm sure that's what he's going through now.
Absolutely.
And I know it's on another level. He's a current top, you know, and he's so many times world champion, but I'm sure he's going, this thing's spectacular. And that's what we read on the face, and that's what I read on Frankie's face when he got off the bike. I happened to be looking, and he looked at me and went, because I think even Frankie's impressed with Marc's ability straight away to get a feel for it.
I mean, what was it, his seventh lap of the session, and he was already 3/10 off what was currently the fastest at that time.
And tricky conditions right now.
Yeah.
It's not a nice... conditions wise are not ideal. It was quite strong wind, but that affects it because every time your front wheel gets a bit light, it gets blown away and then the bike gets unstable, pushes you wide, holds you tight on other corners, you know, depending where you are. But the more important thing is it's so cold that you lose temperature in the front tire. You know, we saw what that did on Sunday,
yeah,
without that wind.
Yeah. Well, even Jorge Martin this morning crashed at turn 11, didn't he?
Exactly.
Same crash that Jack Miller had in the race.
And that was on the 24 bike, his first run out on it, Martin. And they've just got it going and he's just got out again, so it's fully repaired. I'm sure they're doing a quick shakedown before the track closes so they can make sure it's ready for this afternoon.
One thing that's also been quite interesting, you just have a quick look.
Yeah, that's
the KTM
cool.
Has some KTM camouflage, some pretty trick new aero on there. It's quite different to anything we've seen before. It's got like this almost wing that feeds into a channel down the side of the bike as well. Something we've not seen really ever.
Yeah, I mean,
almost.
If you look at
Zarco's
bike from this year, it is along those same lines, isn't it? The belly pan is wide,
yeah,
like the Aprilia one, and it had a little channel on where, uh-huh, the KTM has taken that and run with it. It's a massive channel down the side. And obviously in those camouflage colours to make it a little bit tricky to see all the shapes.
Yeah, yeah.
They've obviously spent a lot of money developing it,
well,
and don't want to lose it at the first test,
exactly,
someone copying them.
They're
but it does look like the bike you're seeing on the screen right now, Pecco's. Those front wings on the new KTM fairing look very similar to that. And you know what I think we're seeing is not so much copying now, like it used to be in the beginning, but development is heading the same way because of the aero. Like cars start all looking the same,
yeah,
because the aerodynamics lead it that way. You know, and that's what I think we're seeing.
Yeah.
Everyone's ending up in the same place, you know.
Aside from obviously all the talk with Ducati and Marc Márquez, I believe there's a very, very small chassis tweak, isn't there? I don't know if you've seen that yet. There's a small,
sorry, on what was that?
A small chassis tweak on the Ducati, spotted, I think it's on Pecco's, Enea's, and also Jorge's bikes here this morning. But aside from that, we haven't really seen anything new from,
yeah,
from
so
that much.
So, what they were all brand new, shiny, and stand out a bit because of that. But I said, David Tardozzi on the live, and that I can't see anything different, Davide, externally. Yep. And he said, you won't, because they're identical. And I said, well, what's different then? Electronics, you know, suspension, engine. And he went, engine. Admitted that the engine is 24 engines different, otherwise the bike's the same.
Yeah.
I, like, remembering from past years, Ducati like to bring out the more visible stuff a little bit later. You know, yeah. They've already tested it well with Pirro, yeah. Michele Pirro, and we'll see it, at, I think, exactly. At Kuala Lumpur. So people have less time to copy it.
Yeah, less time to copy, a little bit less time to take that inspiration and use it, as Simon says. Let's jump on to, well, quickly before we talk about GasGas, KTM and everyone else. Also in the Ducati garages, of course, it's Digia's first time in the VR46 garage. He has 123 bike that's the same as Mark's, really, without those updated devices and the tail unit. So does Bez, I believe. He has 123 bike as well, but yep. Still, also, they're all 22.
Yeah, just while we're looking in the... GasGas garage... I've been keeping an eye here because I thought maybe they'd get the carbon fiber frame, but see the air intake on that one there on Augusta's bike right now. That is the latest one Jack ran in the last races of 23.
Yeah.
And so at least Augusta is getting some new, different parts filtered. You'd look at the air intake with a little slot above instead of all the way around. That is the later one that Jack ran. And no, same exhaust, otherwise the bike's the same. Carbon fiber chassis I was hoping to see in the GasGas garage, but after a crash strewn weekend for Jack, he had two big ones.
Yep.
And we know the carbon fiber chassis are quite, what's the word, they're more fragile than aluminium, you know. And so I think they lost a couple, and then Brad had one, he said, we broke it in half. So I think there's up to three lost, and probably why we're not seeing them filtered down to the GasGas garage.
Well, that's a shame not to see that, but a thing that is certainly not a shame to see is Pedro Acosta on a MotoGP bike. Already going pretty well, it has to be said. Every run he's been getting more familiar, but his face, the reaction when he first got off the bike after the first run, it was brilliant. If you're not watching along on the live on MotoGP.com, make sure you do throughout the rest of the day. It was brilliant to see him on.
I think everybody would have that same reaction, you know,
yeah.
First time on a GP bike, just unbelievable power, unbelievable brakes, and basically you're experiencing, like I was saying, everything at a better level than you've ever felt, you know, so you're going to have a big grin. I checked what spec machine Pedro gets, and it's literally poles race bikes, you know,
okay. And
of course he can adjust it to suit him.
Now, we're outside Honda as well, Simon. Me and you have been tracking the Honda story quite closely this year because we're frustrated, really. We want Honda to make a big step. Again, there's a brand new bike here, and it's completely different, again, from what we saw in Misano. It's chassis, swing arm, aero, the whole works. Have you spoke to anyone in the garage to kind of find out some initial feelings and impressions?
The thing is, with Honda, it's the only garage I can't get that. You know, they're like I've been saying for a long time, Honda are kind of isolated on this little island, and I believe it's some of the problem, because these days communication, you learn things from other, you know, especially if you're not leading. But I've got feedback from other garages, not Yamaha yet. I was going to do that at lunchtime, but no, I haven't got feedback from the garage. The thing is, Honda has. Their bike is the most different so far that I've seen from anyone's.
Yeah.
Yamaha's close. They've probably got the most changes as well. Uh-huh. But that makes sense, doesn't it? Ducati visibly the least changes, but they're leading the way. And Honda and Yamaha, who are having the most problems, have the most radical changes. You know, Carl, one of his bikes is very different. So you saw that. Completely new chassis. They're running those big exhausts. They've got different aero. Like, they're really trying as well.
Of course, before we carry on about Yamaha, we do just have to inform you, just in case you haven't seen it all, that Johann Zarco and Luca Marini are now on Hondas as well, coming across from Ducati. It was interesting to me, actually, that they started Luca straight away on that new bike, and he hasn't touched the old one.
No.
Maybe, I don't know if you... Does it make you feel that maybe they do believe that bike is a little bit better?
I would... I would say that, yeah. I mean, we don't know the reasons yet. Hopefully we can ask Luca tonight. Hopefully someone on the team talks to me to tell us. Because Johan Zarco did it the other way around.
Yes.
He ran on the 23 machine and then got on the 24, didn't he? And Luca didn't even have the 23, just straight out on the 24. I joked at the time that maybe they just want to not disappoint him too much. And obviously they think that 24 is better. But also maybe it's... This is what we're going to run.
Yeah.
Let's start with that and work on what you want to improve.
I mean, let's hope that is the case. As we see now, Alex Marquez and Augusto Fernandez going out together. Of course, two riders with not too much change on their bikes at the minute. As we do say, Alex had that 23 bike. Now, we touched on Yamaha just prior. We need to get out of the way here because Rafa Fernandez is coming in. Anything else that you've seen down at Yamaha, Simon?
Yamaha. Like I said, aero galore, different chassis on one of Carl's bikes. I'm sure it'll filter into also Fabio's to try. And Alex Rins has just been riding what I think are the race machines of Franco Morbidelli. You know, just getting up to speed, and that makes sense. Frankie's going to have to. Trying to get out of mechanics' ways. We're closing the garage here, so we're wandering out the back.
Yep.
I imagine just getting Alex up to speed, you know. It's going to take some adaptation just to get used to the Yamaha. Yeah. He's coming back from a tough time.
Okay, we need to get out of this garage before they close the door.
Trying to figure out what
Sorry, gentlemen,
want us to
we'll
do.
Be out of it in just a second. Now, as we are exiting one of the Aprilia garages, of course, that was Ralph Fernandez testing today. He has won 2023 Aprilia, the first time that he's rode it. But you were also speaking to Paolo Minora earlier.
Yep.
Did he give you any goodies, any little tidbits of info?
Yeah, what he said was the base bike is the 23 race bike.
Yeah.
You know, they'll have the 24 at Kuala Lumpur, you know, in Sepang,
okay,
in February. So what they're doing is running through each individual part, you know, to check it, and then before making it all in one bike, you know. And so the ones I did get off him were, they had that, oh, there we go, Carl on that very different chassis, and yeah, obviously a brand new chassis. I imagine engine in there as well, you know, next stage.
Let's hope it's better.
Yeah, sorry about that. Now, I forgot what we were talking about.
Aprilia,
Bonora. They ran a bunch of sensors on the back of the seat unit of Mav's bike.
Oh, right.
And so I was like, is that, it looked like pressure sensors or something. And he confirmed that what it was for is to find out rider position, when the rider moves backwards, where they move, where they put pressure.
Oh, really?
Yeah, quite interesting.
Okay.
And the other thing, they had a swing arm out at one stage, so obviously trying a swing arm. He confirmed that, but otherwise saying not many visible parts, but they're all individually getting tested, and the ones that work will end up being on the 24 bike in February.
Okay, well, let's hope that 24 bike is a step forward. Certainly, Aprilia this year, they've been very fast, but just for some reason, inconsistent results, haven't always quite got the best out of it compared to what we've seen them in free practice. There's actually Joan Mir's just about to go out here.
So, Joan Mir about to head back out. He's been doing a lot of laps, and I imagine, you know, imagine his situation, you'd really have some motivation to work hard, find the direction of this new bike, you know, and for 24.
I mean, let's hope it is better. Of course, we know Honda have been working very, very hard. You can see there, just in front of you, the different aero on the screen, and you see now the big belly pan side fairings are much larger than they used to be. So Honda,
then different exhaust,
seat
unit, whole swing arms different,
yeah,
chassis different, and just to confirm that chassis to me and swing arm is swing arm, not so sure. Chassis definitely is HRC. You can tell by all the inserts and that they're not, you know, even if you change a complete chassis, they still use the same inserts to mount where the steering goes through, where the swing arm goes through, and that kind of gives it away whether it's Honda or Kalex, and it's definitely Honda.
Now, anyone we haven't touched on, Simon, maybe Franco Morbidelli, he's been taking a quite steady adaptation, but of course for him, he's probably one of the bigger changes of anyone going from the inline four Yamaha to a V4 Ducati. Of course, he's rode a V4 before on the Honda, but for 1 year, I believe. How big of a change is that for Frankie? It's a massive adaptation. And what do you expect him to do into the early part of the season?
Yeah, just as we see Joan Mir on screen, he's got to be still a little bit sore. Sorry about that. We'll come right back to Frankie. Moment. He's about to head out. He's got a medium front tire, medium rear, heading out to this cold. So some of the guys running softs to make sure they're safe. You see totally different shape on that swing arm. Wow. And that engine, though, to me, is the same engine. It's the same engine.
Yeah.
Sure, they might have a little bit of intakes and exhaust and even mass, like flywheel weight or something to change something, but it's the same engine. It makes that same note. I'd recognize if they change anything, firing order or anything massive, and they haven't. I'm disappointed. I'm hoping to hear something radically different on the Honda. But, yeah, Frankie, as we watch Luca Marini, who's only had the new machine, which is what you're looking at. He's only been on that all day. So, yeah, Frankie, I think, I mean, the Yamaha's a sweet bike.
Yeah.
It's just competitiveness is too low, you know. Horsepower, aero, they need to go forward, you know, and they're the areas that they're working on. And I imagine for Frankie, it's only going to be a nice experience. The thing is, I want to point out, is when you have a bike that's better, you go, oh, this is fantastic. But doesn't matter how good the bike is, when you get to a certain level within that last second, you know, of lap record or pole position, you know, is when the problems turn up.
Yes.
So you're not likely to hear about those until we have better conditions in this cold, windy day. That's what I think.
Well, let's hope that is the same. And of course, someone else getting used to a new bike is Alex Rins too. Alex as well is still recovering from that badly broken leg.
Ah, exactly.
Today, I mean, with the conditions, I mean, he's doing plenty of laps, which is great to see. But if you're Alec, today is probably just one of those days where you just kind of go at 90% rather than doing your full workload, really.
Yeah, I think, I mean, I was thinking about this coming into the test, and it's why I thought before Mark did that big high side is, as we wander into the Grassini garage, looking at Mark's brother Alex's machines, and right next door with the doors down is Mark Marquez's. But I was thinking about it coming into this test that the teams like Grassini, like VR46, are the satellite machines. So they get the 23 proven bike, and they just adjust it to suit themselves. And that is, when you're working like that, just for yourself, it's much easier to go faster. Because all you need to do is focus on the setup for you. Compared to the factory teams, that their focus is not about going fast. It's about to do a certain pace, replicate it each time you go out, as we watch Alex come in. And the factory teams are non-stop changing parts. Little tweaks here, a little part that we might not see, another swing arm, different aero, and then comparing what's better and finding the direction. So what I'm saying is, that's why we see Taka Nakagami, Luca Marini, for example, at the top of the timesheets, because they're riding for the independent team at a test. It's why they have the chance to focus on themselves and go fastest. And it's also why I thought there's a really good chance of Mark Marquez being fastest at this test, because he can focus on himself, and you know what he's like. He wants to stamp authority, you know, on the championship. The only thing that might hold him back is these conditions. He doesn't want to, you know. Same for everyone, though. And the last thing, before I give you the mic back, is that he knocked himself around the other day.
Yeah.
You know? But I think just conditions, it's still a really good chance of Mark being fastest at the end of the day,
well,
because of that.
You're not the only one that thinks that, Simon. There's a lot of people around They do believe that Marc Márquez has a very good chance of being fastest today, and I think after that first run he just went, yeah, okay, he probably will be fastest at the end of today. Well, that's going to about do it here from the midday recap. We've got about 3.5-ish hours left of running still to do here at the Valencia Test. The first day of 2024 has already got us all excited. I know we're going on a winter break now, but, well, they may as well roll on with the Qatar Test in February. But that's going to be it here from the midday recap. Thank you very much to Simon, as always, for bringing us all the info that he has that none of us else can see. And we'll see you very, very soon indeed. Thank you very much. Ciao for now. Thank you.